Good morning. Welcome to the meeting here. I know it's a brisk January morning. It goes for this time of year. I don't know if that's if you don't like the weather, you usually change the week. Welcome to you here. We have visitors. I'd like to have a record of your visit. There's a card and a record of your brother. You can still have a place in the collection plate. We have a nursery that's unattended. It's really auditorium. And if you're referred to the bulletin for a list of the sick and the shut-in, and those that are privileged to serve, maybe some substitution this morning. Our reading this morning will be by Brother Tyler Wall. And I've got a note on here. Butch is back with us. Because John was about to put that sign out. Free kittens, cats, Butch. Anyway. And also, Brother Wallace is out. See you. We're sorry to make these announcements Diana Donaldson's father, Albert Robbins, of Indianapolis, passed away Saturday, and there's no services planned at this time. And Fred Gizzard White passed away Wednesday, and that's the brother of Roy Rothite White of our congregation, and the memorial service will be at a later day. John Wesley Sadler, formerly of Clay County, passed away this past Thursday in Smith County, and his services will be tomorrow at Upton and Hay at 11 o'clock, and visitation is going on from 11 to 9 today, 8 to 11 here. John lived here many years and graduated with Rob and some of the others in the class of 86. And Sadler in the class of 86 is the class that's marked on 9 degrees this week's 13, passed away in the last 31 years or more. There was a 60-something in there. Few updates. Creole Hospital continues to improve after her accident. Linda Boone had the flu this past week, but she's back with us. Lord, Linda, please keep in your prayers. Her heart, her health is deteriorating, and Ruth Parsons' cancer is back. Keep her in prayers. David White is going to get a good report this past week. In prayers, please. And there are others that's listed in the book, and also needs to be kept in prayers. We rejoice when Daniel Strong is restored this past Wednesday night. We're thankful for that. There will be a men's meeting today at 4 o'clock. And also there will be a soup chili meal tomorrow from 11 to 1 at Fire Hall for Jake and Josh Wheeler and family. Anyone wishes to attend. Birthdays. The ninth is Greg Sheffield. The ninth is Jacqueline West. And on anniversaries, Patricia and Ed Arms on the ninth. And on the 13th is Joe and Glenn Scott. Are there any other announcements? Thank you. I'll be reading Revelations 3, verse 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in with him and will sup with him and be with me. Our first song is I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Oh, my soul, rejoice, take joy and peace in what you hear. May sweet sound in your ear. Oh, that sound of every blessing. Oh, that sound of every blessing. Tune my heart to sing thy praise. Strings of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of gladness praise. Teach me ever to adore thee. May I feel thy goodness through, while the glow of endless glory fills my heart with joy and love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, here I raise my Ebenezer, and I hold my good pleasure, safely to my God.
rescue me from danger. In your cross, His precious blood. Oh, to grace thou great adventure, living diamonds great to be. Let thy goodness like a bear bind my wandering heart to thee. Never let me wander from thee. Never leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, vacant, sealing, sealing for thy courts above.
I hope to build from nothing less.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest friend, but only on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness fails His lovely faith, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I live in Him be found. Blessed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
After the prayer, we sing Stepping in the Light.
Our Father in heaven, we thank you that our hope is built on the solid rock of your children. We thank you that there is one God, we thank you for that holy passion which you have of things in the existence. We thank you for our bodies. That there are conflicts that men are continually having things about things that they didn't know before, that their bodies are complex. You are the one that has created and given us life. We pray that this will help people to believe in you. We thank you that seminar of steps to get here this day. We thank you for fellowship. We share with one another. We pray and sing songs. We listen to your word. We give. We pray that our giving of our lives to you will be acceptable to you. We pray that the things we do will be your own glory. We are thankful for the Holy Spirit who intercedes for us. We are thankful for the Holy Spirit who gathers us and gives us your word. That your word is true because it is the ability to gather the Holy Spirit. Many times we have this grace, this is always go to your word, make final decisions. That, and we pray that where our decisions are, will be based on your word, that we will obey and agree in a way that is acceptable to you, that you and your word have guided. We thank you for those who teach those who are in America, that are in America, that do not know about you, that the gospel is based with them. We pray that people, your children, each one of
stand as we sing.
Trying to walk in the steps of the Savior, trying to follow our Savior and King, shaping our lives by His blessed example, and we found that in the songs that we bring. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, stepping in the light, stepping in the light. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, letting Him pass the light, pressing more closely to Him who is leading. When we are tempted to turn from the way, trusting beyond that He's strong to defend us, that we have happy our praises each day. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, stepping in the light, stepping in the light. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, letting Him pass the light. Trying to walk in the steps of the Savior, upward still upward we'll follow our guide. When we shall see Him, the King in His beauty, happy, how happy our place at His side. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, stepping in the light, stepping in the light. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, waiting back of
life.
Morning.
Morning.
Right before we started, we talked to Butch right there. And Butch said that if I went for longer than 30 minutes, then he might have to get up and leave. So I want to be sure and finish everything within 30 minutes, just in case anything comes in, Dan John, and he needs to respond this morning. We are absolutely thankful, and it's wonderful to see Butch back, because it's too easy for people to find excuses not to come to worship, and it's a wonderful thing to see somebody who is going to sit through and endure pain in order to come to worship. And I'm thankful that he's my uncle, and I'm thankful that we have that as an influence here this morning. Last week, we looked at 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11, which said, "Who among men knows the thoughts of a man except for the spirit of a man which is in him?" From that, we looked at the hidden man of the heart. We began looking at the hidden man of the heart, and we imagined that inner room, that room that exists deep within us, in which we think through our thoughts and we decide our course of action, where we hopefully decide to follow Jesus and we decide to fight against the evil things that the devil would have us do. But inside that hidden man of the heart, and who we are on the inside, that's who we looked at last week and who I want us to keep looking at this morning. Because we all can understand the fact that sometimes who we are on the outside and who we are on the inside is not the same person. From that verse there, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11, last week we established from that text that there is that inner man, that he exists, he resides deep down within you, And regardless of who people see you for on the outside, then that is who you are. That hidden man of the heart. Paul said, who among men knows the thoughts of a man except for the spirit of the man which is in him? Paul is acknowledging the fact that there is this person who exists deep inside of you. Secondly, from that we establish that you're the only one that has keys to that room. It says, who among men knows the thoughts of a man except for the spirit of the man who is in him? No one knows what's going on inside of that hidden room except for you. You may allow people to access that room by their teaching, by their influence. You have brought these people in. Perhaps you have hung their portraits on the wall. And the decisions that you make based not only on what Jesus would have you do, but on how these people have influenced you in your life. You can also choose to share with people what's going on inside that room, but you're the only one who has control of the key. You're the only one that has access to that room. Who among men knows the thoughts of a man? No one else knows that, only you do. You are the only one with access to that room, access to that inner man. And thirdly, from that text, we establish that God doesn't need a key. Because who among men knows the thoughts of a man? God already knows. God's never been bothered by any sort of law. And we learn those things from that text. Now also last week we looked at how that room can become a dangerous place. Because we people rot from the inside out. Because the devil sometimes convinces us that we will not be held accountable for what takes place inside that room. That the devil convinces us you can let that hatred exist in there because no one knows about that hatred. You won't be held accountable for that. Don't worry about it. The devil convinces us that there'll be no consequences for the things that take place on the inside, in that hidden room. We feel safe there. We feel secure there because no one else can find out our secret. But God knows. God always will know. And so that room can be a dangerous place because of the false assumption that we have about the safety, about the sanctitude and the privacy of that room. This morning I want us to look at a few more elements regarding that hidden man of the heart so that we can understand that room, that person a little bit better, and so we can begin to improve that person. That's why we began this study in the first place, because of that New Year's resolution to be better. And instead of focusing on losing pounds or gaining muscle or quitting drinking Cokes or whatever it may be and to make our outside body better, then we need to focus in on that inside body, that inner man, and how to make him better. First off this morning, what I want us to understand is that hidden room. I forgot to replace the batteries, and then you'll have to do it again. And that inner room, that's where Jesus wants to reside. There in our scripture reading, in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, Jesus there says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him, and he will dine with me, I will dine with him, and he with me. What's Jesus talking about? He's talking about that inner room. Jesus wants to reside there in the inner man. Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. He's knocking on the door of that inner room, and he wants to come inside. He wants to be there with you, helping you make decisions. He wants to be in all of his fullness there in the inner part of your heart. David wrote, create in me a clean heart, O God. And Jesus also said, blessed are the pure in heart. David, that in the psalm, said, create in me a clean heart. And Jesus said it in Matthew chapter 5, verse 8, blessed are the pure in heart. So what we need to understand is, how do I become pure in heart? Jesus said, blessed are the pure in heart. How do I make that mean? David said, created me a clean heart. If I want a pure heart, then God has to create in me a clean heart. I was born with a clean heart. I was born with that inner room that was perfectly clean and perfectly wonderful, full of only good things. But then I allowed evil to come into that inner man. I allowed evil to corrupt me from the inside out. And now what has to take place is I have to allow God to create in me a clean heart. Now, how does that happen? Well, Jesus is standing there at the door knocking. And it's up to me about whether or not I want to allow him access. Now, he can prick my heart with the word. He doesn't need access to see what's going on in there. But now I need to allow him access to come in there and dwell and dine with me, to be a part of that inner man. How is it that our hearts, that our inner man becomes clean and pure? 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15 says, sanctify Christ as Lord in your heart. Jesus is standing at the door knocking, and Peter says, sanctify him as Lord in your heart. Some people out of the world are confused about what one must do in order to be saved. Sometimes you'll turn on the television, and maybe there's a guy preaching on there. He has a big smile and white teeth, and he has a wonderful, uplifting message lots of times. But then right there at the end of that, when he gets right to the end, to the conclusion of that sermon, then he ruins the whole thing. He says, now, if you want to be saved, then just accept the Lord in your heart. And that's all you have to do in order to be saved. Some people miss some of the essential elements of salvation and repentance and in baptism and devoting your life to Christ. But then there are other people who have all the elements there. You have to make that good confession before men. You say you believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, and you are baptized and you repent. You do all these things. But then people sometimes may go through all this process outwardly, but then they never sanctify Christ as Lord in their heart. They say, yeah, I believe in God. I believe in Christ. I believe that the Bible's true. I believe that I should go to church and I should sing songs and I should try to do good, not do bad. But then whenever I really want to do something else, and that's what I do. Because I refuse to sanctify Christ as Lord in my heart. Lord, Master, he's the King of my heart. If I want to live a good life, if I want to live that good life that lasts for eternity in heaven with God, then it all starts with me sanctifying Christ in my heart. Allowing God, allowing Christ to dwell in that inner man, because that's where he wants to live. Secondly, I want us all to understand that this hidden room, this inner man, that eventually that will be opened up and seen. Everything that goes on there in that inner room, eventually that will be made known to everyone, to God. It will be put on display. And we mentioned just a moment ago, and we talked about it last week, how we allow people to live in that inner room with us. And if you imagine, again, going into that inner room, and hopefully you see Jesus there as he wants to dwell in that inner room, but then we see portraits of different individuals on the wall, different people who have affected you by their influence, by the type of life that they live, or by the things that they have taught you. We hopefully see good Christian people hanging all around the walls of that room. Now, there are certain people that I have hanging on the walls in my room that whenever I start to do something, I think, well, is this something that God would want me to do? But then secondly, I think, well, how would Papa Clyde handle this situation? What would he do? Or what would Papa Roy? And we have these different, lots of times it's our grandparents, our fathers, our mothers, our favorite preachers, and these different people, and we say, how would they handle this situation? But then also guiding my actions lots of times. Now, I'm not sure if there's actual Bible evidence to prove this thing that goes on in my mind or not, but it sure has helped me to do a lot of good things and to keep away from a lot of bad things. The story of the rich man and Lazarus, after both of them had died, then we see that the rich man was carried away into torment, while Lazarus was carried away into Abraham's bosom. Both of these individuals were in that Hadean realm, and they're waiting the day of judgment. And as the rich man was there in torment, he looked up and he saw Lazarus in Abraham's bosom. And he cried out Lazarus for just a little relief, but then he also cried out that he may be able to go back and warn his brother. Now, I don't know if anybody else has this line of thought or not, but I believe that that man was able to see his brother and understand what was going on here in this world. And now what drives me to make a lot of the good decisions that I've made and stay away from a lot of the bad decisions is that I not only think, how would these people handle this situation, but I think, what if they could see me? And what if my Papa Roy saw me doing this? How would that make him feel? And I don't know who else might think things through that way, but I've stayed away from a lot of things. I think when I want those people who have passed on, those people who are awaiting the judgment day and they're in paradise, when I want those people to see me doing what I'm doing right now. And certainly we all understand that concept that we don't want people, those people that we love, those people that we care about, we don't want them to see us doing bad things. That's the whole concept of sin and connecting sin with darkness. And those people who love to do sinful things, they love the darkness because they don't want those deeds to be made known. You see, when we do things wrong, we do those things in private. We don't want people to understand that we have this addiction. We don't want people to understand we have that problem or that we've committed this sin. Brother Glenn Collins said that he remembers growing up in Texas and the drive-in theater there. Drive-in theater wanted to have a good name, so they gave all the preachers and the preachers' families free passes to the drive-in. He remembers going to that drive-in, and he imagines the judgment day, like that drive-in. Like all of a sudden your life will be put up on that big screen. And there with all the people around and with God, then you watch the different things that have happened in your life. And then you're judged by those things that are seen there on that screen. You see, those things that go on deep inside of me, those things that I have done that I think no one else has seen them, no one else knows about these things, all of these things, they may have been done in secret. But eventually they'll all be made known. Eventually they'll be put on display. In Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13 says, "Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all. For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil." Eventually, that thing that you're trying so hard to keep buried deep inside, that'll be exposed. You may hide it. No one else may know about it. You may even forget about it yourself. But eventually, it'll be put on display. Even those things that exist down deep dark in that room where no one else can see, where no one else knows. All of these things one day will be put on that big screen on display during the judgment. So then God, Jesus, wants to exist in our inner room. We know that everything that happens there eventually will be put on display. And so what can I do about it? What can I do about my inner man? How can I improve myself from the inside out? Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14. It says, "For this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in the inner man, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all fullness of God." Paul here, we looked at that prayer this morning in our Bible study class. But Paul here is praying for the spiritual well-being of the members of the Ephesian church. He says that he prays for them to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in the inner man, that our inner man can be strengthened. We looked at that passage in 2 Corinthians last week. Our outer man depends, our inner man can be renewed day by day. So how am I able to renew that inner man? How am I able to strengthen that inner man? That's what we need to do in our lives to make sure that we are living the way that God wants us to live. First off, I may not be able to keep temptation from coming in, but I can keep it from setting up a precedent. You know, there may be things that happen around me, and somebody may do something to me, and it just makes me so mad. Jesus got angry, but Jesus didn't let that anger dwell in him. There may be some pretty man, pretty woman, or some handsome man that walks by you, and you may think about them, and you may notice how handsome or how pretty they are. That doesn't mean that you have to dwell on that thought like King David did. You see, we can't always prevent things from coming into our mind. Sometimes we may not be able to prevent seeing someone and the nice things that they have and envying, saying, well, I sure wish that I had what they have. But just because I can't keep those things from coming in doesn't mean that I have to allow them to stay. I can't keep a stranger from coming and knocking on my door in the middle of the night. But just because someone comes and knocks on my door, that doesn't mean that I necessarily have to invite them in to sleep on my couch, which is what most of us end up doing with these sins that enter into our heart. We say, well, you know, I wish I had what they had, and boy, that's a beautiful thing, and I wonder if I couldn't just figure out some way to make that happen. And we start dwelling on this thought. We start dwelling on perhaps that hatred or that envy that we have. And eventually we allow it to set up residence in our heart. And eventually that thing, let me ask you the question, what tempts you the most? This thing within yourself, what tempts you the most? We all have different things that tempt us, but more than likely you're able to think of what tempts you the most. Right now, what one thing? And probably you didn't have to think too hard to come up with. You see, what we have to do is we have to understand that just because that thing tempts us doesn't mean that I have to allow it to stay. We need to fight. We need to fight as hard as we can to get that out of our inner room, to clean house. We've got to fight to get it out of there, and we say, you know, you can't sleep on my couch any longer. We've invited this thing in, and we've allowed it to rest there in our inner man, and it's a part of who we are now. It's inside our home, but what we have to do is we have to fight to get it out. Now, it would have been a lot easier to not allow it in there in the first place, but now we have to try to get it out. Secondly, so I can't keep things from coming in, but just because they come in, I don't have to let them stay. Secondly, I've got to repent. I've got to change. That means I've got to keep that room clean. You know, I hate for people to get into my truck. It's embarrassing for people to get in my truck. I like my boys to come in there, but other than that, I get embarrassed sometimes. I get embarrassed for people to go into my workshop over there. I'm embarrassed because they're both a wreck. You know, I get in my truck and I do this activity, I do that activity, and all these things just pile up. I've not been able to allow anybody to sit in the passenger seat of my truck for at least 3 years because it just stays piled up with stuff. And my workshop, if you went in over there, it would just be a mess. Most people would say, oh, this is disgusting. You know, there's just dust everywhere and tools piled up and wood piled up. And, you know, it aggravates Steve to death, I'm sure, because he owns it. I've got all my stuff piled up in there. But, you know, I get upset when people tell me you need to clean that out. Somebody comes and tells me, man, your truck's a mess. You need to clean it out. I know I need to clean it out. I just don't like to clean it out. You know, most of us, we don't like to have to clean up this huge mess that we've made for ourselves. Now, it would have been easier to not make the mess in the first place. When I got that truck and it was all clean, it would have been easier just to keep it clean than to let all these things pile it up and then have to go through. And when that workshop was clean, it would have been easier just to not let it get a mess again. But I have let it get messy again. And so now what I have to do is I need to fight to clean it back out. And then what would be the easiest scenario is me keep it clean. And that's the way we are spiritually. We have made big messes in our lives. And we have to fight to clean that mess up. But then after we clean it up, we need to just try our best to keep it clean. So that we don't have to go through that fight again. So that we don't have to go through the struggle again of going in. It's a lot easier to pick up a tool as you get it out than it is to go into this big, huge pile of tools like a hurricane went through and try to figure out who goes where and what's what and this is a part of that drill. And, you know, it's a lot easier just to keep it clean as you go. It may not be fun, but sometimes we've just got to make up our mind and keep our inner man, keep that room clean. Thirdly, you've got to pray often. If you have the right attitude, you don't have to worry too much about trying to find the right words to pray. If you have the right attitude, the words aren't really that important. Psalm 19, verse 14, David writes, "Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my Redeemer." So let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart. Sometimes I don't have to think of the right words to say because God knows what I'm meditating on in my heart. I have the right attitude and I'm praying for God to help me, whether I know how to ask Him or not. I'm praying for individuals to be strengthened, whether I know how to say that the right way or not. But can you have the right attitude? When you go to God in prayer, are you praying for the right reasons? Are you praying the right things, whether you're saying the right things or not? Are you praying for the right thing? Can you pray the hard prayer? In Psalm 26, verse 2, we find the hard prayer. Some things are easy to pray about. Some things are not so easy to say in a prayer. I remember a gospel meeting up at Tompkinsville. And Keith Parker asked the question, can you pray? We all say that maybe we're ready. We know that we can die at any moment. We know that the judgment day can come today. But can you pray, Lord, I hope it's today. Can you pray, I hope that you return today? That's a hard prayer to pray. That makes us look at our own lives and say, well, you know, maybe I'm not ready. Maybe I'm not ready to meet the Lord. I haven't been living the way I ought to live. Maybe I can't pray that prayer because I have this loved one. I have an aunt, an uncle, I have a brother, a sister, and I've not made the effort to go and try to bring them back, and I know that they're lost. I can't pray for the Lord to come back today because I know that my sister's lost. I know that my brother's lost. Now, that's a hard prayer to pray, but in Psalms chapter 26, verse 2, we have another difficult prayer. David writes, "Examine me, O Lord. Try me. Test my mind and my heart." Now, we look, God doesn't need keys. God's never been bothered by a lock. He knows what's going on in that inner man, in that hidden chamber. But are you brave enough to grant him access? Or do you just want to do what most people do, put another lock, deadbolt, another chain? I don't want God to see what's going on inside of me. And we try to hide it deep down. David said, "Examine me, try me, O Lord. Test what's in my heart. Look into my inner room at who I am on the inside." Now, can we pray that prayer this morning? Can you pray that prayer? Do you try to hide? Sitting there in the pew, do you try to hide from God because you know that who you are on the inside isn't who God wants you to be? Lastly, if you're struggling with something on the inside, if there's something that's caused you pain, something that you're struggling with and you just don't know how to handle it on the inside, you need to unlock the door. You need to open up the door to that hidden room. And we all work hard to try to create an image. We put out a lot of effort so that all the people around us see us in a particular way. Now, we all decide what image we want people to see. Some people may want others to see them as a bad guy or a rebel. And some people may want them to see him as this sweet little Christian girl. We all get to decide how we want people to see us. But oftentimes we're so afraid of letting people see who we really are on the inside that we hide that. We hide who we are on the inside. We don't let people see the real us lots of times because of the disease that we have let exist there within that hidden man. We allow ourselves to rot from the inside out. We build these fortified walls around that room in order to keep other people out. We call ourselves strong. But really, strength is found through that vulnerability. You know, it's hard to admit that I've done something wrong. It's hard to say that I struggle with some sort of sin. It scares us to death, our secret getting out. But what if everybody in here was feeling the exact same way? What if everybody in here had something deep down that they just don't know how to handle on their own? We just don't know how to get over it. I pray about it. I search the Bible, and I know that I'm not supposed to do it. I just can't overcome this on my own. What if everybody felt that way and everybody was too scared to do anything about it? You see, if we have some problem, some issue that we can't get over on our own, then we need to open up that door and allow other people in to try to help us. We should stop worrying about keeping up appearances and what my brother might think of me. We should start worrying about the condition of that inner man and trying to make ourselves healthy on the inside. James 5, verse 16, James writes, confess your faults one to another. He doesn't say there, confess your sins one to another. I don't necessarily have to tell Rocky everything that I've done wrong in my life. What I want to confess to Rocky is my fault, my shortcoming, the thing that I struggle with in my life. And he says, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. How are we supposed to handle each other? I'm supposed to open up that room to you. Because there may be something I just can't handle on my own. And if I open up that room to you, then you pray for me. We pray for one another. We strengthen, we uplift, we encourage one another. And with each other's help, then we overcome the issues that we can't overcome on our own. This morning, are you ready for the Lord to create in you a new heart? Are you ready for the Lord to come in and clean out that inner room and make it just like new? Maybe you need to become a Christian. Maybe you need to obey the gospel and be baptized into Christ and have that blood wash away all of that evil that has been there in that inner room. Perhaps you're a Christian and you just need to come and you need to confess your faults so that we all together can pray one for another, that we might be able to overcome. And if you are ready to help or to clean out that inner room, and you need help doing that in any way, then we ask you just come as we stand and sing.
I'll consecrate my life to thee, my Savior.
I'll live for him. Live right for me. My Savior and my God.
Pray for the Lord further and give their guidance.
On this Lord's Day we assemble round the table of the Lord. Happy hearts are made to tremble when we hear His blessed word. We recall His broken body as we look upon this bread. Give me thanks, divine and eating. In my memory, He said, and this crimson cup reminds us of the great scene on the road. When He died in pain and anguish, there His blood was made to flow. There in agony He suffered on the cross for you and me. Now upon the throne He's reigning, blessed Lamb of Calvary. Thanks to God for such a Savior, now enthroned in heaven above. Thanks for this exalted favor, bless the glory of His love.
Most kind and most heavenly Father, so thankful for this opportunity that we have to sit around the table. Father, as we take this loaf, may we set our mind back to the cross, Father. Remember that great sacrifice that you gave your Son to go across the Calvary for sins. Father, as we take this loaf, may we do so well pleasing under the presence and pray in your Son's name. Thank you. Father, we pray as we give back to the Father's kingdom blessings. Remember all the things that you did for us each day. We pray in your son's name.
On the song. How many did we have?
47.
47. Let's stand.
Blue skies and rainbows and sunbeams from heaven are what I can see. The Lord is living in me, I know that Jesus is well in the mind today. He makes his home in my heart. Evermore will I be all alone, since he promised me that we never would part. All mountains, green valleys, the beauty that surrounds me, all make me aware of the one who made me all. I knew that Jesus is well in the mind today. He makes his home in my heart. Nevermore will I be all alone, since he promised me that we never would part.
Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we're so grateful for this day that we've had, the beauty that you place around us. And Father, we pray that we always realize that everything good comes from you. And just pray that as we travel through this world, that we always let our lights shine and do our very best to use your wisdom in our decisions. And Father, at this time, as we look around us and see people struggling and people with health issues, we pray that we would look for ways to assist them. And Father, we just pray that you be with those families right now that are grieving. And as we depart from this place, we pray that you guide each of us and direct us. In Christ's name.